Okay. So today we are very, very fortunate to have Her Grace Kirtida Sundari Mataji with us. And Mataji is going to give us a class on the holy name. And this will be a two-part seminar. So the part one will be today and part two will be next Monday. So a sincere thanks to Mataji from the bottom of our hearts for giving us this very important seminar. Mataji, Kirtida Sundari Mataji, you can take over. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Kirtida Mataji, and all the assembled devotees. Thank you all so much for giving me this opportunity on speaking this such an important topic of the holy name, to which I am nowhere near to it, and will be just repeating the words of my spiritual masters, and of course from the retreat that I've been fortunate to attend by His Holiness Sachinandan Swami in New Vrindavan during the Mother's Day weekend. So we'll be just simply repeating His words and just give blessings from all of you to bless me so that I can speak something relevant and may try to convey the right message that Maharaj was trying to convey. So request the blessings from all of you. Panchakalpa Karajasthi Kata Sindhu Vaya Vacha Patita Nam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namah. So let's start. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manomishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yata Padakalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamscha Shirupam Sagrachatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakam Vitamscha Ye Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namastute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpata Rupascha Kripa Sindhu Vayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasadi Gauri Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Ajay, there is a lot of static from your side.
So, okay. So, static, now it's okay? Or still there is?
Yeah, there's a lot of it is still there. Maybe.
Oh, just a minute. Let me put some headphones. Hare Krishna.
Oh, this is clear. Yes.
This is clear?
Thank you.
Okay.
Yes.
So we'll start with actually I did the prayers. I hope the prayers were clear. And now we'll start with the class. So actually just to start, I just chose a verse from Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Leela, and it's chapter 17 and verse is 133.
नामचिन्तामणि कृष्ण चैतन्य रस विग्रह पूर्ण शुद्ध नित्यमुक्त भिन्नत्वं नाम नामिनो. The holy name of Krishna is transcendently blissful. It bestows all spiritual benedictions, for it is Krishna himself, the reservoir of all pleasure. Krishna's name is complete and it is the form of all transcendental mellows. It is not a material name under any condition, and it is no less powerful than Krishna himself. Since Krishna's name is non-contaminated by the material qualities, there is no question of its being involved with Maya. Krishna's name is always liberated and spiritual. It is never conditioned by the laws of material nature. This is because the name of Krishna and Krishna himself are identical. So this is the quotation from Padma Purana. That's what the prophet says. So taking shelter of this verse, and that there is no difference between the name of Krishna and Krishna himself. Actually, there is no difference between the name, form, qualities, the paraphernalia of the divine couple of Krishna in regards to the Krishna himself. They all are identical. So that's why I chose this verse, and through this verse we'll start on. Okay. Jaya Jaya Shri Chaitanya, Jaya Nityananda, Jaya Dvaita Chandra, Jaya Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya, Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale, Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine, Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharini, Nirvishesha Shunyavadi, Paschata Deshitarini. So, I'm really, you know, reluctant on somehow speaking on this holy name, because as I said that I'm nowhere clear, nowhere near, you know, of my chanting is not on a Shuddha Naam. But still, I just take up, you know, this topic so that it may purify me. And the more I speak, the more I get purified and more I get enthused to chant better. So that's why I took this topic, and moreover to share what I learned from Sachinandan Swami retreat. But it's really on a very high level topic, because whatever services we do in Krishna consciousness, all the services are just 1% of our Krishna conscious. So you can imagine, you can involve yourself in cooking, in cleaning, in deity worship, taking care of the family, taking care of the home deities, temple deities, doing temple activities, doing all kind of festivals. You know, all these services are just 1% of the whole Krishna consciousness. And the rest 99% of Krishna consciousness lies on the fundamental base, which is the chanting of the holy name. So chanting of the holy name is the 99% of our Krishna consciousness. So imagine the whole thing, whatever services we do, the basis is the chanting of the holy name. If the chanting is proper, the outcome of the services will be proper. If the chanting is not good, the outcome is not good. That's the relationship. They are directly proportional. So that's why, you know, the focus and of course the goal, the sadhya and the sadhana, the both in Krishna consciousness is the same. That is the chanting of the holy name. When we chant the holy name of the Lord, we get the love of Godhead. And after getting the love of Godhead, what it is the chanting again the holy name of the Lord. So it's the summum bonum of everything. So the ultimate objective is also to reach to the level where we chant the Shuddha Naam, the pure name of the Lord. That should be the objective of this chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. There is no other objective. Because as the meaning of the Maha Mantra that Srila Prabhupada says, What is the meaning? When we chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. When we chant this mantra, we are praying to the Supreme Divine Couple. We are praying to Krishna, who is all attractive. We are praying to Srimati Radharani, Hara, which is the internal potency of the Lord. And we are praying to Ram, which can be either Lord Ramachandra or Balaram, but on the highest platform is Sri Radhika Raman, which is the pleasure giving, the highest pleasure giving. So we pray to them just to engage us in their service. So that's the real meaning of the Maha Mantra, where we pray to the Supreme Lord to engage us in their service. There is no other meaning of chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So we have, in our life of Krishna consciousness, we have gone through many verses that glorifies the chanting of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. There are so many glorifications that has been mentioned in various scriptures, in various Puranas. We know the famous verse, Hare Nama, Hare Nama, Hare Nama, Kevalam, Kalonasteva, Nasteva, Gatirannata. So three times it says that there is no other means, no other means, no other means in order to oneself liberate oneself from this cycle of birth and death. There is no other means. So this only the mean is to chant the holy name. In Srimad Bhagavatam, in 12th canto, there is a nice, verse that says, I'll not go to the verse, but the translation says that even a person who is stumbling and falling on a deathbed, but helplessly while passing away from the world, he somehow takes the holy name of Krishna. Then he is liberated from the bondage of karma and attain the supreme destination. So somehow, if one takes the holy name of Krishna, that somehow word is such a thing, that even if accidentally one takes the name of Krishna while passing away, then he is liberated from the bondage of karma and attain the supreme destination. Alas, the fools of Kali Yuga have no desire to chant and worship the Supreme Lord. So that's the verse, that's the meaning of the verse. And in other places in Srimad Bhagavatam, especially in the 6th canto, while the description of Ajamil is there, it says that even if one jokingly utters the holy name of Krishna, then also he is liberated. So we see that holy name is so potent that it can open all the doors of material desires and the doors of spiritual desire. So there are quite a few verses, but we have to understand that why we are chanting the holy name. What desire do we have? What gate do we have to open? Because the holy name is so potent that it can open all the gates of material desire and the gates of spiritual desire. But we have to understand that what is our hidden motive while chanting the holy name. So, Srila Prabhupada says that the holy name is to be chanted just to receive the love of Godhead. There should be no other desire while chanting the holy name of the Lord. The only desire should be to get the love of Godhead, to awaken our dormant love for Krishna, or to revive our eternal relationship with Krishna. That should be our only motive, to chant the holy name of the God. Sometimes we do chant for some other, material gains or for somebody's health. But this question I raised up to my spiritual master, and he said that for all the best of the things, we can pray to the Supreme Lord, but the thing of chanting should be specifically for the pleasure of the divine couple and to awaken our love of Godhead. That should be the and only desire when we chant the holy name of the Lord. So we see that just chanting once, you know, either jokingly or somehow, you know, this holy name can give a lot of benedictions. You know, so it can literally liberate us from the karma and jnana. But still, not to frighten anybody, but still it says in Chaitanya Charitamrita, in Adi Leela, Bahu janma kare yadi shravana kirtana, tabutana paya krishna pade premadhana. That despite one's endeavor to chant the holy name for birth after birth, one will not get the love of Godhead, which is the ultimate goal of the chanting. Because to get the love of Godhead is the only ultimate goal of chanting. So one will not get, if one is infected with the offenses in the chanting of the holy name of the Lord. So this offenses that we commit in chanting the holy name of the Lord is the only impediment that doesn't provide us to come near or get the ultimate goal, which is the love of Godhead. So we all know various offenses. We have all memorized it. But how many of us do follow it? Because yes, those offenses of obeying the orders of the spiritual master, offenses, you know, like, okay, we don't consider the name of Lord Shiva or Lord Vishnu or Lord Brahma to be equal to or independent of the Lord Vishnu. We understand basically all those offenses. We don't blaspheme the Vaishnavas. So all those offenses we do take care of. But the underlying thing is, why on first part we have a fear of committing those offenses? And that is where this retreat starts with, that yes, we do commit some offenses only and only when we are inattentive while chanting the holy name of the Lord. That is the only reason because of which we commit offense, and thus we don't get the results of our chanting, because of which inattentiveness, because of we are inattentive, so we don't focus on the chanting of the mantra, and thus we don't get the desired result. We don't get enthused in chanting the holy name. So only and only reason is we are inattentive while chanting the holy name of the Lord. Now, why we are inattentive? What is the reason of us being inattentive while chanting? So actually, Rupa Goswami in Vidagdha Madhava, he says, and it's also mentioned in Chaitanya Charitamrita and Anta Leela, it says that I do not know how much nectar this two-syllable Krishna have produced. Because when the holy name of Krishna is chanted, it appears to dance within the mouth. We then desire many, many mouths. And when the name enters the whole of the ear, then we desire millions of ears. And when the same holy name dances in the courtyard of the heart, it conquers the activities of the mind, and therefore all the senses become inert. This is the highest stage of chanting the holy name of the Lord. Now, how many of us really experience this stage of Prema Bhakti, where we really desire to chant more and more rounds, 24/7, where the holy name Krishna dances on our tongue, where we desire millions of fears to hear the holy name, where, you know, the whole activities of us are conquered and our senses become inert. How many of us do experience, at least talking about myself, nowhere near to this position? Chant because I have to complete my rounds. Chant because I have taken a vow of chanting 16 rounds. Once 4 to 6 morning or 5 to 7 in the morning, 16 rounds done, bead is on the side. Bead bag is always on the side. So how to enthuse oneself that we can constantly chant the holy name of the Lord with pure 100% attention. So that inattentiveness, what I was talking about, it comes when we don't have the eagerness to chant the holy name of the Lord. So Satchinandan Swami was giving so much stress that we should have that eagerness to chant the holy name. If the eagerness is not there, then definitely our chanting will be full of inattentiveness and will be leading to all the various offenses. And thus will get nowhere near to chant the Shuddha Naam. So the feeling of joy and that enthusiasm that yes, I have to reach to my right destination, that is not there. We all know that our only destination of chanting the holy name is Shuddha Naam, is to go home back to Godhead, where again we'll be chanting the same Maha Mantra and with full attention, with full enthusiasm. So that is not there. So definitely, you know, that enthusiasm is not there, and so that eagerness is not there. But that doesn't mean that we become disheartened. Oh, I don't have that much eagerness, so that means I don't chant. But no, that should not be the case. Practice makes man perfect. So we have to keep on chanting. Like example in Nectar of Instruction is always given. The famous example that if one is suffering from jaundice, the only rectification is to eat sugar, right? Now when we eat sugar, when we are in the stage of jaundice, when we are infected with jaundice, that sugar tastes bitter. But that's the only remedy, right? That's the only remedy to clear off that jaundice. That is to keep eating sugar or the sugar cane juice. No matter it tastes bitter, so what? But keep on taking it, right? And the stage will come when the same sugar tastes sweet. So that means we have been cleared of our jaundice. That should be the case for chanting too. No matter we don't have eagerness, no matter we don't have enthusiasm right now, but still the rectification, the remedy is to keep on chanting continuously so that at one point of time we get that stage where we are enthused with eagerness to chant the holy name. That should be the case. And how to do it is to align our day-to-day activities. And when we align our day-to-day activities and we take up the beads, the first activity that we do when we wake up in the morning after our body cleanliness, if we take up the beads and chant and take it as our priority, then the whole of the activities, the day-to-day activities, will definitely fall in place. Otherwise, it will not. It will not. That is for sure. We may have lined up things in our day-to-day activities, but they will not fall in place if we don't give priority to the chanting of the holy name. But yes, if the chanting is perfect, everything falls in perfect. And while chanting, what we have to bring in? We have to bring in the shift of our consciousness. Because of this chanting, there is a shift in the consciousness, and because of which all the other activities fall in place. And we try to prioritize the things. And when the shift of consciousness happens, that's when the transformation of the heart takes place. So that goes all side by side, hand in hand. So Maharaj was actually telling, he basically designed his retreat into five parts. So the first was align your body, mind and heart. The second was Sambandha, that is chant with the feeling of being a relative to Krishna. Third is chanting to be in the mood of service. Fourth is Vipralamba, that is chanting with the right mood, longing for Krishna. And the fifth is Sharanagati, where one wholeheartedly surrenders to the Lord. So these were the five parts in, you know, five parts in which he break the whole seminar. But unfortunately, he was able to cover only the three things. The first three, that is align your body, mind and heart. Second is Sambandha. And the third is chanting in the mood of service. The next two, that is Vipralamba, chanting with the right mood, longing for Krishna, and the Sharanagati, where one wholeheartedly surrender unto the Lord, he was not able to cover, but he promised that in 2019, in the same place in New Vrindavan, he will cover the rest two parts. So I have just, you know, the information for the first three, and out of this first three, hopefully today we will be able to cover the only the first part, which is aligning our body, mind and heart, because it was such a detailed seminar. So doing justice to this, I'll just try to cover the first part, hopefully. So yes, coming on to the point that Maharaj was explaining, that how while chanting there should be a shift of consciousness, and then finally the transformation of the heart. Now how that transformation will happen, so to that also he gave the four parts, which is forming intentions. So first of all, before taking up the beads, we have to form our right intentions. And what is that right intentions? We have to enthuse ourselves positively that yes, I have a potential which I have never used before, but from today onwards, I will make the best use of it. That should be our intention. That is forming intention. We have to form that right positive intention that yes, whether that today I will chant attentively and I'll use all my energy, all my potential, whether we'll succeed or not, that is again a different issue. We don't have to go on to the results. Right now, only forming the right positive intention is what is important. Next comes the action. So we have to take a proper action. If we don't act according to our intentions, then we will get the poor results. And when we get the poor results, our belief that yes, the transformation of heart will happen, that will become weakened. We will not be able to transform ourselves because there will be no shift in consciousness. Because the intentions that we have formed, we have not acted upon that. But once we act, then definitely success is there. Though that action may be a small baby steps, it should not be 100% that we form intention and then we focus only on acting 100%. No. The accumulation of small baby steps that we take while doing the action on our base of what intention we have formed will yield high results. So we have to remember that Rome was not built in a day. So just taking small baby steps, we can think of getting some success. So what happened when we get little success? When we get little success, we gain some experience. right? So some positive outcomes come, and then we grow in our spiritual life. So that's what when transformation happens. And finally, the fourth is the self-belief. Because when the confidence develops, then our Shraddha, then our trust, then our faith in Krishna and in Krishna consciousness, that get deepens and we eventually grow in our spiritual life. So these are the four things. I'll repeat. The first is forming intentions, the right positive intentions. The second is acting on it. Action should be there, but with the mood of taking small baby steps. And then third is, with those baby steps, there is a transformation because we get positive outcomes and then we grow. And the fourth one is self-belief, where the confidence we develop, we get more Shraddha in Krishna consciousness, and eventually we grow in our spiritual life. Now in this five-part seminar, the first is the align your body, mind and heart that we will cover today. Now, how to align your body, mind and heart? It can be summarized in one single word, that is being present all the times. So this Maharaj was giving a scenario. He mentioned that if some guest, you know, comes to your home, he knocks on the door and you are not at home. How does the guest feel? The second scenario is, okay, if owner is at home but does not open the gate but does not welcome you wholeheartedly, how does the guest feel? And the third scenario is, owner is at home, open the gate, welcome the guest, and in due course of time gets engaged in some or the other activities and forget that the guest is here. How does the guest feel? Same applies to our chanting also. In this scenario, we, the soul, is owner and Krishna is the guest. So we have to welcome Krishna or the holy name with full alignment of our body, mind and heart. We have to acknowledge that yes, Krishna is here, knocking the door, open the gate, wholeheartedly welcome the holy name, and moreover, always be conscious that yes, holy name or Krishna as a guest is here while chanting our japa. That should be our consciousness. 100% always aware and acknowledge that yes, Krishna and holy name, in the form of holy name, is here in our home, in our room, and we have to give 100% attention to it. Because we are not in present, because we are not present there, so the holy name doesn't feel good. The guest doesn't feel good in the form of holy name. So the real transformation, that is the process, it requires mind to be always present. Only then the change of the heart or the transformation of the heart will happen. So first we have to align our body, then mind, and finally the heart. So this alignment, the Sanskrit word comes from yojana, which means the alignment, which means to connect or to join. So Maharaj was telling that this word alignment, it comes from the French word aligia, which means to arrange things in their proper priorities. For example, if we are going for a long drive and constantly our car is showing that the fuel level is low and we just take it for granted, okay, I'll get the fuel done, I'll take the gas, and we just pass on, a time will come we might not get a gas station on the highway and the fuel level is so low that our car cannot move forward. So at that time we are stuck, right?
And at that time, we can't even think that, okay, gas station is not there, fuel is not there, let me put water. That doesn't work, right? So we cannot replace the fuel with water. So similarly, in our day-to-day activities also, we have to prioritize our chanting. It's not that, okay, my chanting is there, I'll do it. Let me do this. Let me take rest. Let me take this work. Let me clean up this first. Let me do this laundry. Let me do this work. Let me go for my 9-to-5 job. We have all sorts of excuses we can make. But if we keep on making excuses, the time will come that it's night time. Either we'll be chanting in the night time in full mode of ignorance, or our chanting will be passed on to the next day and we will be covering up. Because ultimately you have to chant, right? Because if somebody who is initiated and who has taken up a vow, then they have, I'm using the word have, because then they are bound to chant, right? Because of their vows. So that have part you have to do, just like you have to fill your car with the fuel. You cannot replace it with water. Similarly, you have to chant those 16 rounds. You cannot replace with any of your other services that you might be doing in the temple or at home or in your office or anywhere. You have to that time chant. But if you keep on delaying it, either you'll be chanting your inattentive rounds, or you'll be just finishing your rounds, or you'll be chanting in full mode of ignorance. So that should not be the case. The first thing is, on the day starts, we have to chant. We have to prioritize our life that, yes, let me first chant and then I will align all my other activities. So proper alignment of body, mind and heart together will give the real effect on the holy name. After this, Maharaj was giving, Sachinandan Swami was giving, the example of Ranganath Temple in South India. Many of you might be from South India. I have not been to it, so can't share my actual realization to it, but will be just repeating his words. That yes, he said that there are various gopurams or gates through which one has to pass in order to get that magnificent darshan of Lord Ranganath. So similarly, in order to have darshan of the Super Soul or Krishna, or have Krishna dance on our tongue, we have to pass these three gates and align them properly. When we pass these three gates, then, you know, when our chanting is on a Shuddha platform, then we can have the darshan of our Super Soul or darshan of a worshipable Lord. So the first gate is the gate of body. The first is the gate of body. In this regard, he mentioned that the first part is proper sitting posture. So while chanting, you don't have to be lethargic. If you feel that yes, you are really tired, don't take up chanting at that time. Better give your body proper rest. If the body is not restful, the chanting will not be good. Because chanting has to be done in a proper sitting posture. To that, he gave various recommendations that yes, first of all, make your body 100% restful. Then sit in a proper, comfortable position, and your spine should be straight. It's not doing any kind of a yoga that, you know, you have to be stiff, but yes, sit in a comfortable position. Try to keep your spine straight, and for that he recommended that keep a little, you know, higher cushion kind of thing under your lower part, so that your lower back is raised little bit, so that you can sit comfortably in one asana for a long period of time. And I have experienced it, and you know, that really helps. So that is what he said, that your posture should be proper. So these are the various ways that he recommended while sitting properly. And then secondly, he said to pay attention to listening means proper pronunciation of the whole mantra. Means there are 16 words, 32 syllables. Even if we are not 100% attentive, but try to chant the whole mantra. Don't miss out the word. That's what he said. And for that, try to listen your chanting. Chanting involves two processes, speaking and hearing. If one of the process is missing, then the chanting is not proper. Don't murmur the words. Say the words in a full proper pronunciation and focus on all those 16 words and try to hear it. We may not be able to do this for the whole 16 rounds, but again, as I said, that practice, as Maharaj actually mentioned, that practice. Keep practicing and then you will come on a platform of Shodhanam. So two things, right? Proper sitting posture. First of all, wherever you do your ignorant activities like laying down, sleeping, or just relaxing, try to avoid those places. If you are relaxing on a couch, and especially bedroom, don't chant in your bedroom, because, especially on the bed, because your mind knows, your mind is trained that on a bed you do all ignorant activities like resting, sleeping. So the mind tends to sleep. Moment the mind comes to know, okay, you are on your bed, you need to sleep, and then that, you know, that lethargic come over during the chanting also. Leave that place immediately for chanting. If you are resting on a couch, don't sit on couch. Don't be in a very comfortable position, because then the mind slips over. You have to be in a comfortable position, but not on a very comfortable position while chanting the holy name. And the next, of course, is hear the mantra. Involves two processes, hearing and speaking. This is about the gait of body. If your body is really lethargic, really you cannot focus on, leave the chanting at that time. Don't be so strict that, yes, I have to go get up 5 o'clock in the morning, no matter, till 2 o'clock I was in a festival in the temple. Either align your activities or be easygoing in the sense that, yes, now my body is not supporting. Let me rest for 2 more hours so that I can chant better. So that should be the mood. So give proper rest to your body and then chant. The next comes the gate of mind. Train your mind that past is gone and we have no influence on future. Mind is very tricky. It goes to the past, it goes to the future. So train your mind that past is gone and we have really no influence on future. So better to be in present. Understand that whatever we are today is the aggregate or the sum total of our past activities. So if our past can determine our present, so why not our present may determine our future, right? So thinking that in line, ignore the past because it has happened, focus on present so that we can shape our future better. There's a beautiful poem also known as Jiva Soul by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, in which he says, forget the past that sleeps and never the future dream at all, but act in time that are with thee. Thee means the Supreme Lord, and progress thee shall call. So that's what his prayer says, a beautiful prayer. And that's one of the beautiful poem. And in one of the beautiful poem, this is what we say is that, yes, we have to forget the past. We don't have to fear for the future, rather always be present. Also in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 7, Chapter 15 and Verse 42, it says,
अक्षम दशाप्रणम अधर्म धर्मौ चक्रे अभिनम रथीनम च जीवम धानुर्हितस्य प्रणनौ पतन्ति शारम तु जीवम परमेव लक्ष्यम. What does it say? That when the living entity decides to go back home, back to Godhead, he gives up all his conditioning. All his conditioning means all his bodily conception of life, all his past, all his future. He gives up everything, all his false identity also, that I am so and so. And with the help of the bow, what is the bow? Is a mantra, the transcendental chanting of the mantra. He throws himself in full mood of surrender unto the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, which is the target. So this is a beautiful, you know, verse. I really liked it. Actually, in this seminar, Maharaj didn't cover it, but Sachinandan Maharaj gave a wonderful class on this verse last year in Sadhu Sangha, and it was so wonderful that I really relished that class a lot. And it has become one of the famous verses for me now. So that mantra is the bow, the arrow is the spiritual soul, and the target is the lotus feet of Krishna. So we have to, the soul, that we have to take that bow, we have to take that mantra, and then we have to keep ourselves, that is our soul, as an arrow, and we should shoot the target unto the lotus feet of Krishna. So that should be the mood. Now how to do, basically how to do it is to form a goal. Because if we have specific goal in our life, to achieve that goal, we need a mercy of the spiritual master and Krishna. And by their mercy, we can train our mind that yes, I have a certain goal, so now I have to fulfill. Because if there is no goal setting, then it is just like rowing a boat, not knowing where to go, and we end up rowing in circles. So if we don't have a specific goal of chanting the Shuddha Naam, and we keep on chanting our bad chanting, then bad chanting will yield to bad chanting, and will yield to bad chanting, and will yield to bad chanting. So it will go on and on and on, the process will go on. So at one point we have to cut down it, and we have to understand that yes, now is the time when I have realized, so let me set up some certain specific goals which is achievable, and thus train my mind so that I can achieve. Now once the goal is formed, then you have to train the mind accordingly. Try to bring the mind back under to your control, rather being controlled by mind. So that should not be the case. Fix a proper designated place to chant. When we have a fixed place to chant, then we can train and tame the mind more easily. Because if, like in our home, we have a specific area, right, where we have kept our deities, so we know that this is that designated area where we have to be really cautious of. We don't have to take the slippers off. We don't have to keep it, you know, at the aside something which is not, you know, valid for our home, because that is a designated place for the deities. So that place we have to keep it exceptionally clean, because that is the designated area. Similarly, for our chanting also, I'm sorry, we have to fix the proper place, so that we can train our mind that this is the place where I'll be chanting, and so no more extra invalid thoughts comes in. So Sachinandan Swami then explained that how the chanting goes, and then what are the different stages to pass this gate of mind. So sorry, he gave a proper presentation, to which I'll just explain that first of all, we dive into the shallow zone. Imagine there is a river flowing. You are on the bank, you are on the shore of a river. So you just come forward, dip your feet into that river, which is a shallow zone. And then, you know, you come in contact with the river, just, you know, maybe till your feet or up to the knees you are in the river.
So that is the shallow zone. How can we connect it to the chanting is that yes, we are chanting, we have started our chanting, some flow of thoughts will come, various thoughts comes and go, but still, we are still in the water. We are still fixed in our chanting. So similarly, we are in the river, waves will come and go, but still, we are fixed. We are in, right now in just the shallow zone. The next is, we have to come on to the stage where we walk into the river of the holy name, little more. Remember, we have a river, now we are walking little more. Maybe submerge ourselves till the navel. Right now, still not on a very deep platform. We know the ground and you know where we are and we are just standing, maybe the river up to our navel. From there we are standing. And what we are doing? We are doing tarpan. We are taking the water of the Ganges and we are giving back to the Ganges. This is how we worship Ganga, Mother Ganga, right? So similarly in our chanting also, we have little more gone ahead in our focus, in our attention, and where we worship the Harinam Prabhu, again with the holy name of Lord. With the holy name of Harinam Prabhu, we are worshipping the Harinam Prabhu. And then comes the third and final stage, where we go in the middle of the ocean, we have nowhere notice of the ground, and we just go with the flow of the river. Right? So that is the highest stage where we have to aspire for. So that's what in chanting, where we have to chant so deeply that the chanting takes the process and chanting, we just go with the flow of chanting. That should be the highest. So these are the three stages he mentioned. And the practical tips to attain these things, three things he said. The first one is where we are just on the shallow zone, where we have to focus on the first word, Hara. Hare, in the Maha Mantra, we have to first focus on the first word, Hare. So whenever we are chanting, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Now the next mantra comes, Hare. So focus on the first word, Hare, whenever we are chanting. Then comes when we go little deep inside the river, where we try to focus. So maybe 2-3 rounds, just chant in this, focus only on the first word, Hare. And then focus on the entire mantra. Now when we focus on the entire mantra, he was mentioning that we should focus on the Hare part more. Like Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Now next comes Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So the first Hare and the second Hare which comes before Rama. If we focus on these two, then the entire mantra will be able to focus. Right? Just to give an example, that Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. First Hare is done, now next Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So the first and the second Hare, if we focus on, then Krishna and Rama will fall in place and thus the entire mantra will be focused. So that's how when we do Tarpan. Now we are focusing on the whole mantra. And the third, when the flow of river takes us along, is when the mantra carries you. So now few rounds with just chanting on the focus on the first Hare and few rounds chanting focus on the whole mantra and finally the mantra will take us away. So the key point is to bring our mind back. In Bhagavad Gita also Krishna says what he says that from wherever the mind wanders due to its flickering and incense nature, one must certainly withdraw it and bring it back under its control, under the control of the self. So the point is to bring it back. Always being present and bring the mind back. Bring it back. The sincerity of the chanter lies in the number of times one brings one's mind back to the present moment. That's how it should be. Because half of the time when we chant, we don't even realize that our mind has wandered away. If we don't understand that we are deceived, will not seek the remedy, will not see a doctor, right? So understand that, yes, we are deceived. So understand that while chanting that, yes, the mind is going away, we have to be so cautious, so present in a moment that, yes, at least understand that the mind is wandering. Don't ever think of that chanting with full wholehearted attention. At least understand the point. You understand that, yes, the mind is wandering away, bring it back. Bring it back no matter what. Sometimes, you know, especially for the chanting, some important thoughts that come up, oh, I have to do this, I have to do this, I have to do this, I have to do this. If something really bothers, take a pen and paper with you. Write it down. Okay, I'm holding my beads, I'm writing down. Okay, after my chanting, I'll do this. Fine, mind is trained. This is the practical tips that Maharaj was mentioning. Mind is trained. Okay, I have jotted it down. Let me finish this mantra and I'll come back to it. Okay, after a few rounds, another thought came in. Okay, again jotted down. List it down in a pen and paper. Okay, let me finish. I have listed it down. Train your mind. I have listed it down. Okay, I'll take care of it. But right now, let us chant. So involve your mind. Don't ever say your mind, let me chant. Let us chant, because you have to involve your mind also in chanting. Otherwise, it will not be trained and it will just wander away. So this is how. And the second what he was telling is that always chant thinking that Krishna is listening to your chanting. Your spiritual master is hearing you chant. How we do it, right? When your spiritual master come home, how wonderfully you arrange your home, right? And how wonderfully you reduce your sleep. How wonderfully, you know, without any effort, you can go long and long in serving your spiritual master. But it doesn't happen in the case of chanting. So if we think that, yes, our chanting is being heard by our spiritual master, imagine how attentive we can. Not what to talk about spiritual master. Even if we just see that, okay, our friend is sitting, if we are chanting in association, we see that, oh, somebody is there, okay, I have to chant. So the same thing we have to practice in our daily life, that even if we are alone, we have to chant with that proper mood, that yes, someone is hearing my chanting. What if, you know, it just goes on that, oh, that person is chanting so this way, that way. We don't want that yet. So we have to always understand that somebody is watching us constantly. So we have to chant in that mood. And we have to chant for the pleasure of the divine couple. And while trying to bring our mind back, so Maharaj was explaining that we don't have to be so forceful while bringing our mind back, because what you resist always persists. Rather, we have to train it properly with the adequate force, right? Train it properly. Don't be too harsh on your mind, right? Train it properly, like the strings of mridanga. There are different strings on mridanga, right? If one of the string is loosened, you tighten it. But if you tighten it little more, it gets break and the voice of mridanga gets disturbed. So just like the strings of mridanga, they are so delicate, at the same time it has to be enough hardened so that the proper sound from both the sides of the mridanga comes. So that should be the mood. Train your mind in such a way that it should not be too harsh and it should not be too lenient that the mind just wanders away and try to control you, rather you controlling the mind. So that's what the practical tip he gave. But he said finally that all this comes through practice. If we practice it well, only then it will come. So that's how you train your mind. Another example that he was giving is of breaking the chain, right? If you are doing something for a long period of time, and now when we attend such retreats, right, so we try, when we hear it, try to implement it and try to break the chain that we were following. So whatever methods of chanting when we were following, if it was not giving the desired result of chanting on a Shuddha Naam, then try to break that chain. keep on, that practicing should always be there. Okay, I have been doing this, now let me break that. And now I have attended such retreats, some seminars, some classes, now I have that knowledge, so let me try to apply it. Only then the change will come. The example has been given of an elephant. When the elephant is a baby elephant, he's tied with a pole, with a chain, iron chain. So that baby elephant tries to move, but it cannot, because the baby elephant doesn't have enough strength to break that chain, right? So the elephant is tied up, right? It cannot move, it cannot go, and it cannot break the chain because it doesn't have that enough strength. But then the same elephant grows up, the chain is still there, still he tries to go, but doesn't have that enough strength. And so finally, what happens, that the same chain of that elephant, it gets transferred to the mind, right? Now the chain is not there. Now the same elephant, when grows up to the big elephant, where he has the strength to break that chain, but he is still not able to, because now there is no chain also. That person has replaced the chain with a small single rope, which is nothing even for a baby elephant to break. What to talk about this grown-up elephant? But now the chain has got transferred in the mind of the elephant. So what happened? Now the elephant is tied with the rope, but since the chain is transferred to his mind, so the elephant is thinking, oh, it's impossible for me to break this. So he doesn't even try to do it, right? So he doesn't even try to break it, though it's just a simple rope which elephant can break. But since it has been transferred, the chain is transferred in the mind, so the elephant doesn't even try to break the rope also. So that should not be the case. We should accept, we should not accept that bondage. Every time, whenever we hear, we have to try to implement it, no matter what. So that bondage should not be transferred to our mind. That yes, oh, I am a Baddha Jiva. No, we have to constantly practice that yes, now is the time. Yesterday I was not able to chant 16 rounds properly. Okay, no worries. Today I'll do it. Today also not. Okay, tomorrow I'll do it. Every day you have to say that today I will transform, I will chant properly so that I can bring a proper shift in my consciousness. That should be our mood. We should not be tamed by mind, but rather we should tame the mind. And life will keep on giving so many problems. Endless problems life will give on, endless problems. There is no end to it. But as Bhaktivinoda Thakur in Jayava Dharma says that yes, life will throw lemons on you. But if you keep on complaining that lemons are sour, and I cannot hold it, I cannot taste it, then you can be on one side. But if the life throws lemons on you, you have to learn how to make a lemonade out of it. Because if you make a lemonade out of it, you can relish it. So that's what Maharaj was bringing up this point, that don't blame the circumstances in whatever we are. Accept those circumstances and try to focus even in those circumstances. So life will throw lemons, you have to make lemonade out of it. So that's how we enter and pass through the gate of mind. Now comes the gate of heart. But before that, it's already 12 o'clock. So it will take another 15 minutes. And so I request all of you, you can just unmute and tell whether I should go for it or shall I cover it next week.
Go for it. That is my choice.
I think you should go for it.
Okay. Go for it. Mataji, please continue.
Okay, so the next thing is the gate of heart. Thank you all so much. So let me just finish it. And it's not a big topic. So the gate of heart, Maharaj was telling that involvement of heart is so important, as it's the resting place of our super soul, our worshipable God. So there are three hearts. First is the physical heart that pumps. So biologically, if we see, that is the heart that, because of its pumping, that keeps us alive. So that is the physical heart. Next comes our emotional heart, where we have all kinds of different emotions. And what are those emotions? Where we have some kind of attachment, some kind of expectation, some kind of appreciation, etc., etc. So that's the emotional heart. But what happens if our emotional heart breaks? Then our physical heart gets impacted. The physical heart gets affected, and one tends to get a heart attack. Example, we can just easily relate to it. I have enough money, spend it in some marketing, get lost to it. Since I have attachment to that money, what will happen? Oh, my money is lost. Oh, my money is lost. Just keep on, you know, it's getting in depth in our heart. And so finally, our physical heart gets impacted. And that's what heart attack is. So we all know that how, you know, this thing happened, and we are quite aware of that how this attachments to some things can yield us some expectations, and when it is not fulfilled, you know, it breaks us. So that's how emotional heart gets affected. But the third comes, the spiritual heart. In that spiritual heart, in this we experience all spiritual things, like being grateful at every step, as this is the real resting place for the soul and the super soul. This is the place where the soul and the super soul reside together. Where, you know, the example is always given in Bhagavad Gita, we all are aware of, two birds sitting on a tree. One bird is enjoying, eating the fruit, the other bird is just watching as an overseer, as a witness. But the moment that bird realizes that, yes, I am eating, enjoying the fruit, but not acknowledging the other bird, then it's just a materialistic way of life. But the moment that bird acknowledges, yes, the other bird is there, and turns the face towards him, the other bird, that, yes, you are mine and I am yours, at that time, you know, the real transformation of heart takes place. So Maharaj was telling that whenever we chant, we have to chant in the mood that acknowledging the presence of Krishna as the super soul in our heart, and constantly praying to Krishna that, yes, today I have turned my face to you. You know, there's a beautiful verse in Chaitanya Charitamrita, in Madhya Leela, in chapter 22. And verse 33, it says, Krishna tomarahana yadi bale ekabara maya banda haite Krishna tare tare para. Just once, ekabara, one is immediately freed from the clutches of maya if he seriously and sincerely says, my dear Lord Krishna, although I have forgotten you for so many long years in this material world, but today, I am surrendering unto you. I am your sincere and serious servant. Please engage me into your service. Learn this verse, memorize this verse, memorize its meaning, and say it before your chanting. When you start your chanting, say it before even you pick up your beads, that yes, for so immemorial times I have been turned my face towards away from you, but today somehow I have realized it, and I'm turning my face towards you, Krishna. And today I have realized that I want to become your sincere and serious student. So please accept me and engage me into your service. If we say that, then we can, you know, get connected through our heart to the super soul. And to that, what Krishna says is the famous words, Sakrit eva prapanno yas tavasmi iti yachate abhayam sarvada tasmai dadami etat vratam mama. That's the famous verse where Krishna says that it is my vow that if anyone once, sakrit eva, once, only once, if one seriously surrenders unto me, saying, my dear Lord, from this day I am yours, and prays to me for courage, then I shall immediately award courage to that person. Abhayam sarvada tasmai Dadami etat vratam, etat vratam mama. That's my only vrata. Then he will always remain safe from that time. So basically this verse is from Ramayana, Yuddha Kand, and it's spoken by Lord Ramachandra when Vibhishan was coming from the other side, from Lanka, and seeing him, you know, even Hanuman said that, what if he's a spy? What if, you know, if he just came to know our strategies? So to that Ramachandra said, Isakrit eva prapannoya stavasmi tiyachate, that what to talk about Vibhishan? Even if Ravana also comes and surrenders, I'll accept him and I'll forgive him for all his misdeeds. But here he comes to Vibhishan. So anybody who just come once to the lotus feet of Lord Krishna and prays that, yes, from today onwards I am yours and you are mine, then that person is 100% liberated. And he says that Abhayam Sarvada Tasmai, I will make him fearless of all the problems. And that's etad vatat vatat mama. That is my only vow that Krishna says, or Lord Ramachandra says. So this is how, what we pray, that yes, for so many years I have turned my face, so now accept me. And to that reply, Krishna also says that, yes, now since you have turned your face towards me, let me handle you. And at that time, believe me, that this is what we always say, and it happens that Krishna became the charioteer of Arjuna because Arjuna asked for it. So the moment we turn our face to Krishna and say, Krishna, please take over the charge of my life, be the charioteer of my life as a chariot, my life of a chariot as a charioteer, you please drive the way you want, then, you know, whatever happens, that happens for the Krishna's will, for the Krishna's desire, when he takes the charge off. To this, you know, I remember always one of the famous examples that my mentor always gives, that yes, you buy an apple from the market, it is a matter, right? You offer it to the Lord, it becomes prasad. How? Because that spirit enters, that it gets spiritualized when we involve Krishna to it. The moment Krishna is involved in any other activity, that activity becomes spiritualized. So even if we have any sufferings, any lemons that are being thrown by the material nature to us, if we, though it is because of our karmic reactions only, because it's a result, it's the reactions of our karmic actions only, we are getting all those problems, all those sufferings. But still, even if in those, we know that it's because of our karmic reactions, but still, even if in those circumstances we involve Krishna, that yes, Krishna, this is happening to me, so be it, but still I surrender unto you, then those karmic reactions will also be spiritualized. And when we involve Krishna, Krishna takes over it. Right? Just as an apple, the matter is converted into spirit and becomes prasadam, similarly, even our difficulties, which are because of us only, nobody else is responsible for it. We ourselves are responsible. But even in those circumstances, we involve Krishna. Krishna takes away the thing of our spiritual heat. We involve Krishna and Krishna says, yes, it's all because of me, and I will now onwards take care of those sufferings to which we are bound to bear it, right? So that should be our mood while chanting. When we chant in that mood that, yes, whatever is happening to me, no matter what, but I am not going to leave your lotus feet and always surrender unto your lotus feet, then Krishna takes over the charge of our life. Thank you all so much, and sorry to take extra 13 minutes. So that's how we completed how to align our body and mind. And now in the next class, we'll cover Sambandha, that is the chanting with the feeling of being a relative to Krishna. And then the third part also, chanting in the mood of service. Thank you all so much for patiently listening. Hare Krishna.
Sita Sundari Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances. All glory to you. It was such a beautiful seminar, Mataji. So beautiful, so filled with practical applications. And as I always say, when you speak, I feel like listening or following. That's your potency. So thank you so much. I just wanted to say a few words. I don't have any questions because everything was so crystal clear the way you explained. But I just wanted to appreciate a few points that you made. You were talking about how it is actually very, most of our offenses rises out of inattentiveness. And this inattentiveness comes because of lack of enthusiasm, which is very true. And so you were telling how it is important to prioritize our chanting, because if we do chanting well in the morning, then the rest of the things fall in place. Again, that is very, very true. So it's like telling us again about how important it is to finish off the rounds in the early morning itself. And then your example of Krishna as a guest, and that was very nice, three different situations that you've explained, and how we would chant in front of our spiritual master. That was so true. So I also like the other thing that you were talking about while sitting and chanting, keeping a cushion really helps. That is very true, Mataji. It really helps to keep the spine straight. Otherwise, we keep changing positions. That is so true. And the importance of stressing on Hare. You gave a very nice example of shallow water and deep water, about Hare in the beginning and Hare in the second half of the mantra. So, and the elephant and chain example was fantastic. Thank you so much, Mataji. Very, very beautiful class. I'm so looking forward to part two, which will be on Monday. Thank you so much, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Preeti Vilasini Mataji, for actually summarizing the whole class. That shows how attentive you were listening. So yes, you know, I really don't have that potency, but Srila Prabhupada says that even we don't have any potency, still we should speak, because the words that we speak are so potent. We carry the potent words, though we don't have the potency.
Okay.
So still speak on.
Hare Krishna, Kirita Sundari Mataji. Wonderful, wonderful class again. Yes, as I echo also Preeti Vilasini Mataji about so many nice points. Two observations that I wanted to, observations that I wanted to share with what you said. So one thing, when you were explaining how we need to prepare the place, that we shouldn't, you know, do this in the place where we're doing activities of ignorance and stuff like that. And it was just reminding me about, you know, when you have problems of insomnia, the doctors tell you that one of the things they tell you is that they say, don't go into the bedroom during the day when you're doing other activities, that you should leave the bedroom as a sleeping place, and definitely do not many people sit on their bed and, you know, are doing schoolwork or homework or office work or whatever, and they say don't do that because your mind thinks that's a place to work and not to rest. So it just reminded me, just even in material activities, how the doctors tell you a place to sleep is a place to sleep, and you should keep it that way in order to maintain that regimen and that discipline in your mind. Your point about the place to chant should be the place to chant. Everything should be in its proper place is also very, very potent. So it just reminded me of that, of how that's also true in a material sense. The other point I wanted to make is, as you were speaking about sitting in a proper position, so at Sadhu Sangha this past year when I was there, one observation I made which really, really made an impression on my mind was as I was watching Vaisheshika Prabhu chant. So I think I shared this before, that, you know, at some point he started chanting and he was in the center, and the other devotees were kind of chanting around him. But I was watching him chant. The whole time that he was chanting, he did not, well, I was had my eyes closed, but every time I looked, he was sitting straight as an arrow. his hand was right in front of his heart. His eyes were closed, and he was chanting. And he wasn't shaking, no shaking his head, no shaking his arms. He was just completely mobile. You know, he was just, how do I say this, just immobile, just sitting there. And it was so potent just watching him chant. Much less if I could have gotten closer and hear him chant, but just watching him chant, that now every time I chant, I think about Vaisheshika Kabru and his one-pointed concentration, and I pray, you know, that please let me have that kind of focus, because it was very, very inspiring, unbelievably inspiring. And one other point that I was, as you were saying, Sachinanda Maharaj said to listen to the Hare in the beginning of the first half of the mantra, Hare in the second half of the mantra, that I also heard that if you listen to the Hare in between as you're chanting, that your Krishnas and your Ramas will also come very, very cleanly. And I have been doing that once I heard that, and I noticed that my mantra, I become a little bit more... I enunciate the mantra more cleanly instead of swallowing my Krishna or my Rama at the end, at the second part. So thank you, Mataji, so much. So many, it's wonderful to listen to this because it reminds us so many about so many other pleasurable experiences with chanting, and we think, yeah, she's right. I need to go back. So it's a good revitalizer for our chanting. Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Maneshwari Mataji. Yes, that's true. Even I was present there in Sadhu Sangha when Vaisheshika Prabhu was chanting, and it was so pleasing just seeing him chanting. You know, it was saying that, oh, wow, he's chanting so wonderfully. So that should be our motive. And it's so true that, yes, even if you hear, if you remember that how Vaisheshika Prabhu is chanting, okay, I should chant in that mood. So that is also so wonderful. Yes, we have to sit straight and, you know, chant in that mood. And of course, keeping that cushion, as Preeti Vilasini Mataji was saying, is helpful. That yes, it's helpful, but at some of the point of the time, even if, you know, even I asked this question that to Sachinanda Swami, that what if we get tired, and then can we walk and chant? And then Maharaj was telling that chanting is just like worshipping a deity, right? So you cannot worship a deity while moving around. People do chant while walking, but that is not the focused japa. So focused japa is always sitting and chanting. And then he said that yes, maybe at the point, even after sitting on a raised cushion, you feel tired, you can swap the position of your legs. Even if that doesn't help, you can stand for a moment, raise your arms, and, you know, just full-fledged stretch yourself, come back to the position, and again chant the rest of the rounds. So that's what he said. But he said, I really not recommend in walking and chanting. That, of course, like if you say 24 hours chanting, you can do it any position. Anywhere, Naam Nama Kari Bahudanija Sarva Shaktis, you can chant anywhere, any place, in whatever way. But that focused japa of your prescribed number of rounds should be chanted in a proper place, in a proper sitting posture. That's what he was explaining. But thank you all so much. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Preeti Das, Sundari Mataji. Please accept my humble obeisances. This is Vajeshwari Priya Devadasi from Atlanta. Hari Bol, Mataji. Very, very Nectarian class. This was my first time listening to your class. It was very, very wonderful. Where was this retreat, Mataji? In New Vrindavan, you said. When was it, Mataji?
It was this year in Mother's Day weekend, in May 11th to 13th.
I see. Mm. And see, I had a question, but actually you answered it. You know, my problem with chanting is that, you know, sometimes it goes into that deep zone of, you know, extreme concentration, and that puts me in deep sleep. It's very embarrassing. And so I wanted to ask you about, you know, this walking. You know, I haven't tried it, but walking and chanting, but you already answered it. But what are the tips, Mataji, that would prevent sleeping? I mean, that's so embarrassing. I feel so bad after that. But the deeper the concentration, the deeper the sleep. That's my experience.
Mataji, it's not the case. The deeper the concentration, the sleep doesn't come.
right? Because sleep is mode of ignorance, and concentration in and on Krishna is the transcendental mode. So wherever there is Krishna, there is no Maya, and where there is Maya, there is no Krishna. So that's the false understanding we have, that if we dive deep into the concentration of chanting of the holy name, then the sleep comes over. That's altogether the different things. The darkness and the light cannot stay together. When the light is there, darkness has to go. So to this, Sachinandan Swami Maharaj, somebody raised this question too, and to that Sachinandan Swami Maharaj said that yes, when we dive deep into the concentration of the holy name, then what happened? The form and the pastimes of the Lord appear. So it's not that the sleep appears. The sleep, in fact, we get so energetic that the sleep 100% goes away. And that is what he answered. So it's only the pastimes or the Krishna, like the Leela and the Naam, the Roop Gun, that comes forward. That is on the Shuddha Naam, where we just see, because Maharaj made us this practical, you know. He was saying that he made us chant few rounds. Actually, this what I'm saying is just the theoretical knowledge. But when we were there, actually 2 hours from 4 to 6 in the evening, Maharaj, we were chanting with Maharaj. So Maharaj was giving practical tips, you know, and he was making us chant for that 2 hours. It was not a mandatory session for everybody, so few of us joined and few of us don't. So, but at that time, you know, Maharaj was stressing on this point that yes, we should not 100% think of the pastimes, but the pastimes will come. And to that, you know, he made us chant few number of rounds, and in between the rounds, he was speaking something, and he was making us be more focused. And after that, you know, chanting few rounds, then he said stop, and then we all stopped. He said, close your eyes, let your eyes be closed, don't open your eyes, stop the chanting and think that your worshipable deity, whosoever it is right in front of you, and you are offering some tulsi leaves onto their lotus feet. And then he thought, let your mind go on and on and on and on. Don't chant at that time. Let your mind go on. And after seeing your worshipable deity, what is your mind is coming on and on, let it go and see through it. So, and then for 2-3 minutes in the complete silence, since we chanted good number of rounds, and then on to his instructions, we followed his instructions, we saw our worshipable deity right in front of us, and then whatever, like that actually 2-3 minutes was a total pin drop silence, and then Maharaj told us to open your eyes and then to share to your partner what you saw and what your mind did. So that what the mind did was not a contemplation, it was some pure thing that came up. And I was shocked to hear a few realizations that I got with, that so many people, they were with Radha and Krishna. So that's a kind of realization which I really cannot share in words, but it's something, a practical tips that we were fortunate enough to got it. So that's how it is. And then, yes, go ahead. Go ahead, Madhuri.
Can you share at least what you felt? Like, how you...
Yeah, so actually, even I shared the same thing that, yes, since I've been worshipping Radha Golokananda here in his Goa temple, and I've been involved in the personal deity worship and dressing and all, so they have really, you know, I've got developed a kind of attachment with them. So as Maharaj said, so that yes, think of your worshipable deity and offer some tulsi leaves onto their lotus feet. So we did that, even I did that. Radha Golokananda was right in front of my eye, as if, because I know how they are, but after that good number of rounds, chanting good number of rounds, they were right in front of me. And while I was offering tulsi leaves, somehow that vision got disappeared, and immediately my spiritual master came in. So the moment I realized that, you know, it's all in the thoughts, in the mind it's going on, that nowhere I'm close to worshipping Radha and Krishna. Whatever service doing on to them, the personal service, is just assisting my spiritual master in that service. If I say, if I dress the deities, so I'm nowhere close to dress them, but just assisting my spiritual master. So immediately, you know, my spiritual master came in picture in that 3 minutes of pin drop silence, and then, you know, I somehow went with my spiritual master to Radha Govind, and we were doing Sankirtan. So that's how it, you know, it got transformed literally. So that was my realization. But yes, some of the devotees really shared a lot of good realizations, that they had a personal time with their deities. How the deities, they manifest in their, exactly as Radha and Krishna in front of them. So yes, we don't have to particularly think of those qualities while chanting, but as you said, that deep chanting leads to the manifestation of the pastimes. But otherwise, if we are simply sleeping, that happens with me too, but we should think that it was a total ignorant chanting, and try to don't even count on the chanting. If one or two rounds you somehow slip off, then, you know, we should chant it again, because sleep never touches the pure chanting. Hope it answers.
Yes, Mataji, thank you very much. I was looking for a practical tip, and that's the tip that you gave about maybe visualizing your Ishtadev, your deity that you normally worship.
Yeah.
Thank you very
much. Yeah, in between... Yeah, in between, even if we feel sleepy, just, you know, leave your bead bag and open up some good quotations from the beautiful books, Art of Chanting by Mahanadi Maharaj, or some Art of Transformation by Sachinandan Swami, or some good, you know, quotes on chanting. So that will again enthuse us. And sip a glass of water. Because if we find that, yes, we are sleepy. After all, we are in a body, right? So we do tend to have all these things. So let it be. Go with it. Just don't force ourselves. So let it be and go be it. And, you know, do all kinds of things that will just wash your face with cold water so that you can focus on chanting. Leave that, at that time, leave that bead back and focus on just reviving yourself so that you can come out of that sleep. So that's the practical tip.
Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Mataji, what was the words you said, you know, the one in the Srimad Bhagavatam, not the bow and the arrow words, the other words, the one that you said that one should recite that verse before starting to chant every morning, beautiful words, that I am surrendering to you today and from now on I'm, you know,
yeah,
realizing
that.
Yeah,
yes, Mataji. Yeah, that's not from Srimad Bhagavatam, actually. That's from Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. It's from Madhya Leela.
Okay.
Yeah. And the verse is 22, chapter 22, verse number is 33.
Thank you, Mataji.
Yeah. Krishna toma rahana yadi bale ekabara maya badha haite Krishna tare kare pare. That's the verse I'm saying. Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Kirtida Sundri, Mataji, Koti Koti, Denver, Pranam to your Shiva. Right time, right. Mataji, you given such a nice example, and especially how to chant attentively. Mataji, when we are sitting in the temple, Mangala Arati festival day, the Brahmachari deities, and the vibration is totally different, so our chanting is so attentively in japa call also. But if when we are working and I complete my 14 rounds, but 2 rounds remaining after after coming job 4 o'clock, Mataji, that is totally materialist, mechanical chanting, Mataji. And second thing, you give an example of elephant kids, and Mataji, you are given example that when you are sitting in a home, that you feel that Lord Krishna and Srimati Radharani is watching you. And Mataji, sometimes our mind is going I have to do this, I have to do this, all the responsibilities, we remain that. But you have given us such a nice example that we have to keep a slap to our mind and come and chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra. So that Mataji is such a wonderful class. Feel that sitting in Gopinath temple and near Brahmachari Shivata class. Dandavat Pranam Mataji, Hari Bol Hare Krishna. And I have overheard in the Sadhu Sangha, Radhanath Maharaj is sitting with Vaishakhi Prabhu, same posture, Mataji, and how attentively chanting, Mataji. Thank you very much for adding small, small point and guide us, inspiring us. Dandavat Pranam.
Jai, Dandavat Pranam, Vrinda Gopika Mataji. It's because of your sincerity that you took up this class as a sincere class. That I'm nowhere close to all those brahmacharis, my hundred and hundred koti and koti dandavats to them, because they are the real spiritual souls, and you know, they are on the high, very high platform. Nowhere close to it, but yes, as I was saying in starting, that yes, the message is so potent that, you know, that we carry. So that, you know, gives us something that yes, okay, we are not potent, but the message is potent. So we should take shelter of that. So it was such a pleasure meeting you in Sadhu Sangha. So I was so happy that I met you, and it was so pleasing to meet you in such a pure soul. So thank you all so much. Hare Krishna.
Dandavat Pranam Kiti Tasmati Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Dandavat.
Hare Krishna, Kirti Dasundari Mataji.
Jai, Shyamalari Mataji, Ki Jai.
Jai Mataji, you are so amazing, you know. And you gave the seminar, we wanted to join that seminar with the Chidambaram Maharaj's retreat, but we couldn't do that. But thank you so much for taking this subject, you know, for the seminar. Really, really helpful, Mataji. It's like I am like struggling to concentrate on him, holy name every day. So thank you so much, Mataji.
Thank you so much, Shyama Gauri Mataji. Hopefully you can join the next part of the retreat next year. And we all are struggling, sailing in the same boat. And that's why, you know, we should be grateful to all these Maharajas who are constantly holding these retreats on holy name for all of us, so that we can be a better servant.
Hare Krishna, Kirti Dasundari Mataji, very, very wonderful class. I mean, I say class, but it should be the nectar, it's a nectar. Then also question and answer, so it's very, very wonderful. Thank you very much, Mataji. You explained very nicely. I don't know, I don't have any words, but it's wonderful. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Kamadaki Mataji. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Okay, so if you don't have any more comments and questions, so we can wind up the call.
Thank you so much, Abhijit Rasundar Mataji, and thanks to all of you for participating. On to the next video, the Vaishnavi video, Namo Namaha. Anantapurti, the Hindu, the Parthi, right? Only names of the